Y'all doing well? Good to see ya. Mark, I know. Mark, I know. Doing all right. Hope you've had a great week. It's been a beautiful summer week. And we've had some rain that we desperately needed, so that's good. I want you to stand with me this morning. Let me pray with you, and then we're going to sing some songs. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us here this morning. And thank you for giving us a peaceful environment in which to worship. Many of our brothers and sisters are in war-torn areas, and they don't even have a building to go to. And they have been warned not to meet as the church. It could cost them their lives, yet we meet in luxury and comfort every week. Help us not to take that for granted. Father, thank you for bringing us here together today. I pray that you open our eyes spiritually. Help us to hear and to see and to receive the words that you have for us today. I pray, Father, that our praise and worship, our response to who you are, would be acceptable in your sight as we pray and as we sing and as we give and as we listen and ultimately as we respond in obedience to your word. Father, may you be glorified today. In Jesus' name. Remain standing and let's sing in the name of the Lord.
Treasure.
our tithes and offerings this morning, and I'd like for our ushers to ask to pray over our giving this morning, and when we have opportunity to do that. So let's pray.
Let's praise your Heavenly Father, Lord. We thank you for this beautiful building that a lot of people sacrifice for, that we could come in comfort and nice padded chairs to just study your word and learn more about you. Thank you, Lord, for the many blessings that we don't often always give you the credit for. Just thank you, Lord, for our pastor. Thank you, Lord, for our Sunday school teachers. We pray, Lord, for your leadership and direction of guidance as we seek about new ways to be more effective in serving you and trying different things to reach more people in our community. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us and give us the strength to keep on doing what we know we need to be doing in serving you. We aren't members of the church or a clique. We are members of the church to serve you and see people and bring to your attention. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Be seated.
What the fight is.
Our district teaches a revisionist version of history.
God is for us. who can be against us?
Am I right here? Just about everyone else.
The country is just not beginning to realize what unity means, winning under our terms. For 2,000 years, men have been trying to get rid of Christianity. What makes you think that you can accomplish what they couldn't?
They didn't have an 83% approval rate.
That's part of your plan, isn't it? Keep us all divided so we don't realize that you're really chipping away at our freedoms and liberties.
America is a country so blessed to whom much is given, much will be required.
You see those statues and those monuments out there? They say, you work for us. You are out of order, Mr. Obama.
Friday at 7 o'clock, you'll see the movie in its entirety if you come from 7 to 9, and we encourage you to bring folks with you. It's just a very relaxed, laid-back environment. We'll have some refreshments and see the movie. But one thing about this, this is not just a movie, and this is not just a fictional thing where this could possibly happen. These things are happening. They have happened. This is real. And this is something that we need to deal with here and to know about and to pray about. So I would encourage you to come, not for entertainment's sake, but for, to learn and maybe to be moved. Sometimes we need a little encouragement to move forward in our faith. And maybe this is something that will help us do that. So that's Friday night at 7. And there's been so much information that has come to light in this last week, and some of it this morning, and I'll share some of that with you in just a moment.
Steve,
that's very disturbing. Yes, ma'am.
On Tuesday, when we have our seniors' luncheon, I'm going to show God's Not Dead 2.
Okay.
So if anybody wants to come and watch that, they're welcome to come.
Thank you. So Roberta was saying that Tuesday, when the seniors meet for their movie time, they'll be watching God's Not Dead 2. So we need to take a look at that, and again, these movies are right on point as to what's going on in our world today, more precisely what's going on in our country today. I wanted to let you know, please take a look at the bulletin, all the things going on, those birthdays and flowers given and everything else. Our purpose statement is in here every week, and I don't know if you read it or not, but it's true to why we exist. And we need to at least read over that and to start digesting the purpose that we meet together, the purpose that the church exists, not just Homewood, but the church universal. If you'll note things coming up, this week is very busy in a good way. Tomorrow we have the ladies' Bible study going on, and then Tuesday are Golden Angels. We have the movie day we just talked about and lunch. Wednesday we have our Teen Kid and Refresh service, but we also have a brand new men's Bible study beginning at 7:30. It is this time because some folks can't get here at the 6:30 time, and this is just for the men. Jack Jones will be leading that at 7:30 beginning this Wednesday. That time may change, but Jack would like to meet with the guys first and then maybe move from that time or day depending on the availability of your schedules. So keep that in mind, this Wednesday night at 7:30. Thursday afternoon is the Shepherd's Table at 3:45. And there was one person that showed up last time, and I didn't know that person was showing up. I apologize, but I thought no one was coming, so I had called Brandon and told him no one would be there. It is important that we show up this Thursday. If not, we will make some changes about our commitment to this ministry. It's a simple commitment, but it's one we need to honor, and it's one that's easy to do. I know work schedules get in our way sometimes, but other than that, it should be something that we are certainly able to do once a month. So encourage you to pray about that and think about that. It's this Thursday at 3:45. And then our movie night on Friday, and then you can see the other things coming up. Next Sunday is Father's Day, things happening after that. So keep those things in mind. On the back, we have our prayer list and praises and things going on there as well. I was asked to add Charles Gerald to the list. Please add Charles Gerald's name. Was there another that was called in or was supposed to add to that list. Okay, if you think of one, let us know, please. We try to keep this up to date as often as we can each week and make it accurate to what's going on in our church body and who needs prayer, and lifting folks up and also giving praise for who he is and thanks for what he is doing. There's another video that I want you to take a look at here, and it is similar in its the issue that it deals with, but I want you to watch it briefly.
I don't think parents should be telling schools what they should teach.
I don't really understand this idea that parents should decide what's being taught.
Give them a break.
I always viewed homeschooling as somewhat of a cult.
Quiet, inclusive.
The different people.
And normal in some way.
I can never picture myself doing it.
Oh no, those are weird. I'm not doing that.
That was before we had kids, and then we had kids, and
all of a sudden, coming from school, and is this really what I should be doing? Dropping them off somewhere else?
And the teacher said to me, he would not cheat off of you, because you are too stupid for him to cheat off of you. My kid is not going to have that experience.
We didn't have to be a special needs teacher. We only had to be a teacher of our daughter.
The kingdom of heaven is qualifying you to speak into your children's life.
I'm responsible for what we're putting into their head and into their heart.
It changed everything.
I think as a kid, you just want to feel like you're worth it. And homeschooling says you're worth it.
The freedom we had was so worth the small sacrifice it was to teach the kids. Now, 12 years later, I realize it wasn't a sacrifice. It was a total gift.
You are in control. You get to choose curriculum. You get to choose methodology.
It's yours to shape.
You are the perfect person to teach them because you've been teaching your child since day one.
She made sure I had everything I needed. I love her so much.
No one's going to love our children more than we do.
The greatest gift that I was given was my own identity. My parents gave me that.
Go in with an adventurous spirit.
Break the mold. It's really beautiful outside the box.
It's such a great adventure.
Isn't homeschooling like public school at home? Ha! Not even close.
And that opens up tomorrow. Tomorrow and Tuesday in the theaters. Both of these movies have to do with homeschooling and, more importantly, with the right of believers to educate their children. And that's a different sermon, but it's an important one. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. Tomorrow also starts the Southern Baptist Convention in Anaheim, California. The pastor's conference begins tomorrow, and the convention itself, I believe, starts Tuesday and Wednesday. I'm asking you to pray for this convention. Pray for the things that will be talked about, decided on at the convention. There are a lot of things that came to light in the last several weeks, in particular, that were not pleasant, not positive, and the convention is under scrutiny for a lot of reasons. Something I want to share with you in just a moment, something I just found out this morning, and it causes us to think and make some decisions in our hearts and our minds as far as our loyalty and what is first and what's most important in our lives. As believers, as Baptist, in that order. So before we get to that part, I want us to sing another song. So would you join us? Let's stand together and sing There's Something About That Name.
Master, the Savior, Jesus.
good to see you. And sometimes we think, I really don't know if I'm doing all right or not. So somebody tells me. One of the hardest things to do for, I guess, any pastor is to decide what to say and what not to say from the pulpit. And that's my issue today. What to say, what not to say, what to leave out, what to include. I just was studying and looking up about the information about the convention this week because I was hoping to follow along online as it began. And I noticed the promo video was a little troublesome because of some of the issues. And then I picked up our state magazine, The Courier, and read an article that I had not seen before, and it was more troubling. And I want to share it with you. And I debated on whether to do it at the end of the service or not. So I'm going to share it with you now at the beginning of the service because it goes right to what the text is all about. Today we're in the second chapter of Acts, and we're in verses 37 through 47, which, by the way, is the response to Peter's first sermon, the beginning of the church. It's when the Holy Spirit is poured out and the people begin to house the Holy Spirit, be the conduit for the Almighty God's residence, for Almighty God's residence in our lives. That's when the church begins, second chapter of Acts. And so some exciting things there. There's a question about lostness and foundness. Being saved, being lost. It's hard to get people saved when they don't believe they're lost. And sometimes within the church, we find ourselves in the same boat. No pun intended. Sometimes we find ourselves outside the boat. And we think we're all right. So I brought the lifeline. I brought the ring here to throw you. And we're going to talk about that a little bit. But I want to share this with you first. And if you'll allow me a little latitude here and a little patience in the article. Again, I'm reading an article from our state Baptist paper, our magazine. And, this just came a couple days ago. Share it with you. It says the convention, it talks about Disney. This came up back in 1997. If you remember, if you recall, the convention would seem to have little in common. After all, we voted for a boycott of Disney in 1997. That lasted for 8 years. Things seem to have changed. It is obvious Disney has moved even more liberal in its moral values, while the SBC seems at this point to be more accommodating. Early this year, the SBC announced it was offering discount tickets to the Disney parks literally across the street from the Anaheim Convention Center, home of the annual meeting in June. In a Baptist Press article in February, writer Scott Barkley wrote, "Disneyland must be explored. Experience a whole new world through a discounted tickets to Disney." In the article, Jonathan Ho, SBC Executive Committee Vice President for Communications, interviewed Disney travel specialists on how messengers can let down their hair while enjoying all the rides and attractions the park has to offer while in town for the meeting. Why does that matter to us? This is why. Recently, videos of a Disney Zoom meeting with staff revealed some interesting insights. At the meeting, Latoya Raveno spoke of her new role at Disney Television Animation. She shared how welcoming the leadership had been to her, not an all-secret gay agenda. It was like I didn't have to be afraid, like have these two characters kiss in the background. I was just wherever I could, just basically adding queerness, she said. And those are her words. Carrie Burke, a Disney executive, wants to include many more LGBTQ plus characters in the company's films in the future. Disney is a mega corporation, listen to this, a mega corporation raking in billions of dollars with a B in profits each year. Their holdings are massive. Including, these are who they own, ABC, ESPN, Pixar, 21st Century Fox, National Geographic, the History Channel, Marvel Studios, Lucasfilm, majority of Hulu, majority of A&E, majority of Lifetime, FX, Hollywood Records, Core Publishing, Touchstone Pictures, Maker Studios, Steamboat Ventures, Synergy Group, Earth Star Incorporated, and more. The parks owned by Disney have been reported to be their largest source of income. Disney has power and money, but does it have Southern Baptists? Florida passed the parental rights and education law this year, which has everything to do with what we just saw as far as the homeschooling, that prohibits children, third grade and under, to be taught a curriculum involving sexual orientation and gender identity. Disney purportedly has actively opposed this while supporting the LGBTQ plus movement. In fact, many onlookers have accused Disney Pixar of making a subtle statement to Florida's legislature and governor by adding back to the kids' film opening in theaters this month, June 17th, Lightyear, a same-sex kiss between two female characters that had previously been cut from the movie. A Disney spokesperson stated, "Our goal as a company is for this law to be repealed by the legislature or struck down in the courts, and we remain committed to supporting the national and state organizations working to achieve that. We are dedicated to standing up for the rights and safety of the LGBTQ plus community in Florida and across the country." For many years, Gay Days have been celebrated at Disney's parks. Now, according to Disney Diversity and Inclusion Manager Vivian Ware, the staff at its parks have been trained to say hello everyone or hello friends instead of saying ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Disney is further left on social and moral issues than they were in 1997, but thus far there has been no response from the SBC officially. Maybe this will occur at the Anaheim Convention. Perhaps a resolution will come from the Resolutions Committee on from the floor of the meeting addressing this issue. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis has been strong in his opposition to Disney, stating that this huge corporation has crossed the line. Franklin Graham said Disney had gone too far, but will Southern Baptist? R. Albert Moeller, Jr., president of Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, told the Missouri Pathway, "Where we have a consumer choice, we have a responsibility. No one is forced to go to the theater, to a theme park, or to take our children to see these entertainments. We have to understand the responsibility of taking our Christian convictions into the marketplace, and that is perhaps most important when we think about the marketplace of entertainment. Conservative Baptist Network, a group of Southern Baptists who are not a ministry or institution of the SBC, has urged Southern Baptists to attend the annual meeting in Anaheim to choose another family activity rather than support the anti-biblical agenda now clearly present within the Disney Corporation." Why would I share that with you? Because literally, at the Anaheim Convention Center, Disney is right across the street. When you look at their website, Southern Baptist Convention, you can see it right across the street. I shared with somebody just a couple days ago that I looked at the promo video for the convention. And in the video, they advertised Disneyland in the SBC promo video. And I thought, how unusual, because I knew that there had been a lot of back and forth issues with moral things and this agenda being pushed pretty readily by Disney. And then I read this article and I thought, there is a deep problem here. What is that problem? The problem is we don't know the difference in lost and saved. The problem is we have discounted sin to the point of relativism. It's what the thing is today. It's acceptable. It's the normal. It's what we should do, because otherwise our friends and our family and people that we work for and work with will think we're some kind of fanatic. Folks, I want to tell you something. Sin destroys. Sin destroys. It destroys every single one of us. And it is grabbing a hold of our denomination. It has already grabbed a hold and destroyed and has a firm foothold in other denominations. They have caved into the relative moral, whatever it is, conduct of today. And it's taught and preached from the pulpits, taught in the Sunday school classes. And many professing Christians today say, well, that's just how it is. Yes, it is how it is. And we're taught in God's holy word that we are to be different. Lights in a dark world, aliens on this planet. We are to be in the world, but not of it. The problem is, we have a lifeline, and we have something to throw out to those who are lost and sinking. Problems, people don't know they're sinking. There's no sin. There's no problem. I don't need a lifeline. Why are you talking about salvation? I don't need to be saved. The sad thing is they're getting this a lot of times from the church because we're giving in. A wise pastor said many years ago, the church is no longer standing for holiness. It's just 20 years behind the society. We talk about things being bad and sinful, and the world pushes toward being accepting toward these things, and 20 years later, the church is embracing those things, same thing. I don't know what's going to go on at the convention in Anaheim, but I can tell you this, we better be praying. We need to be praying and searching, and not in just in a denomination aspect, but in our own lives. Just a moment ago, I mentioned to you that it's important for us to consider our loyalty to Christ as believers and as Baptists in that order. And I meant that. Our denomination has been under attack for many years, sometimes stronger than others. And I just was taken aback by this article this morning because this is from our state. And on a national level, not only have they kind of said, we understand Disney's stance and that's their deal. We have our own problems, so we're just going to leave that alone. They haven't just stopped there, but they have embraced Disney and promoted Disney, knowing full well that Disney is ongoing, actively, aggressively pushing an agenda that's totally against the Word of God. So I don't know what's going to happen this week, but I know that the church needs to be praying. And I want to mention this to you today. That I don't know about you, but I didn't grow up as a Southern Baptist. I choose to be a Southern Baptist, and I've been a Southern Baptist for most of my life. But I'm a believer first, and I hope you are too. The world we live in right now, folks, is a lot different than the world most of us grew up in. You understand that? And that's why homeschooling is under attack. When I was in the fourth grade, Miss Suther, who was our strict fourth grade teacher, now this was back when they had paddles. Y'all remember that? We talk about paddles. Not. We would have prayer. We would say Pledge Allegiance to the flag, and we would have prayer out loud. And we prayed when we got paddling too, but that's a different issue. The Lord was openly talked about, and we had freedom to talk about that. Our doors stayed open most of the time at the house. If we weren't at home, we were at a neighbor's house playing with their kids, and we could pretty much do that without alarm and wondering what's going on. That's not the world we live in, folks, and that's not where our country is today. Christianity has come under attack and is ongoing. And I can promise you that no matter who the next president will be, it won't fix it. Because this is coming straight from the pit. And Satan's smart. He is the prince of this world. And he is maneuvering and planning because he knows what's coming next. I have been trying to aggressively prepare you for what's coming. To ask us to question what our faith is founded on, how firm we are in our relationship to Christ, because things will get more difficult. And you say, well, that's not very positive. I'm telling you the truth. And the Bible bears that out. That's where that comes from. Whether it's movies about homeschooling and the rights of parents to educate their children being taken away, or whether it's compromise in our denomination, or whether it's compromise in our own hearts and our home, we need to address it and deal with it. Peter does just that in Acts 2. And I want you to hear what he says and hear the response here in Acts chapter 2. And then we'll get back to this thing that we just started on. Look at Acts chapter 2 if you would. We're going to start with verse 37. But when someone starts out, now when they heard this, now I need to back up a little bit because you're going to say, what did they hear? I'm just going to back up one verse because Peter says at the end of his sermon, he says, now therefore let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. Peter delivered a powerful sermon, and he's preaching to all these thousands of people, and he said, this is the Lord, the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one that you've been waiting for, and you crucified him. And this was their response. Now, verse 37, now when they heard this, they were pierced to the heart. Pierced to the heart, it means distress, pain in the mind, smitten in heart with poignant sorrow. They were moved. They were broken. They had a contrite spirit. Folks, one of our problems today is we're not moved about sin in our own hearts, in our own lives. It doesn't mean anything to us. Sin is relative. It's just, I'm not as holy as they are, and I'm okay with that. I don't have to have the biggest mansion in heaven. I just want to get in the gate, and I'm good to go. Peter is preaching a message, and he says, Jesus was crucified because of our sin. And their response is, what can we do about this? How can we respond to this properly? Their hearts were broken. When's the last time your heart was broken over sin in your life? Not your spouse or your neighbor or your child or grandchild or mom or dad, but your own heart. When's the last time our hearts were broken about our own sin? They were pierced to the heart, and said Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? How can we fix this? How can we make it right? Peter responds and says in verse 38, repent and let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repent. What was Jesus' first sermon? Just one word. Repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent. Peter's first sermon, repent. What was John the Baptist's message? Repent must be important. What does repent mean? Repent is to change one's mind. We talked about that last week when we read Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. The being transformed by the renewing of your mind, it means to reverse the direction of one's life, to turn around. In Greensboro, when I lived there for several years, there were several one-way streets. There's several of those in Charlotte. We used to drive in Charlotte when we were kids. Mama didn't care. I'm just kidding. It wasn't as dangerous a place as it is now. But I was driving in Greensboro, and it's a one-way street. I was only going one way. I didn't see the sign. I just thought it was great. There wasn't a lot of traffic going my way. I head down this road, and then I see headlights coming at me. And I look around, and all the cars that are parked facing me. No one's going my direction. And then I notice a sign one way, do not enter. Too late, already entered. The car with the headlights heading toward me is a police officer. Okay, this is going to get really bad really quick. He was probably just shaking his head. I couldn't see him from the headlights, but I put it in reverse and backed up. I backed all the way up the street and out. He didn't turn his blue lights on. He probably felt sorry for me. But I had to get out of there. There's only one way. You can only go one way. Police officer's in front of you. The one that enforces the law right in front of you says one way. You can't go this way. Then back up. That's repentance. You got to back up. There's only one way to go. And sometimes we're headed down the wrong way. And God says, whoa, I'm in front of you. I'm the one that enforces the laws. I made the laws. Back it up. That's repentance. To back up. Go the other direction. That's what it means. Peter preached it. John the Baptist preached it. Jesus preached it. Repent. This is not for everybody else but me. This is for me. This is for you. In our attitude or our actions or our words or our thoughts or our responses to people, we have to ask for forgiveness. Because it is not every day that we walk around in complete 100% holiness and obedience to God. Have you said or thought or done something in the last week that you shouldn't have? I don't want you to confess to me, I'm just asking. Did you have a short word with somebody? Did you cheat somebody? Did you take more money than you should have? Did you not return when somebody gave you more change? You thought, that's karma. No, that's stealing. Give it back. It's good if we don't, you know, we don't charge people too much, but sometimes when they give us a little extra change, we feel like it's a blessing. And we should return it. Now, sometimes they don't take it back. Fine. But you made the effort. Sometimes we just have to say, God, forgive me. I've sinned here. And he does. He's faithful to forgive. And people say, what are we going to do? Peter says, repent. Let each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And just a note here, you can't pick up this in my translation, maybe some of your translations, but the forgiveness of sins doesn't come from the baptism. It comes from the repentance and the placing of faith. The baptism is part of the obedience. It's an outward sign of what's going on. Forgiveness is release from bondage or imprisonment. It's liberty. Forgiveness is freedom, folks. It is freedom. Why would we stay in bondage when we don't have to? Ask God to forgive us and repent. Turn away from that bondage. Some of us sometimes are headed headlong into bondage, and we know what the Bible says, and we know what we've heard and we've learned and the songs that we sing about, and we just hit it as fast as we can go back into some bondage. Why? Why would we do that? Forgiveness is release from bondage, and he says be forgiven. And receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now this is new to folks. This is the New Testament, the New Covenant. Receive the Holy Spirit, for the promises for you and your children, for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call to himself. And with many other words he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Be saved from what? This perverse generation. Be saved from my neighbor? They worse than I am? Is that what that means? Be saved from this person that I work with because they have to be of the devil because they just act crazy. Is that what that says? The word here, be saved, is from perishing. To save from the evils which obstruct the reception of the messianic deliverance. The evils that hinder us from what God has promised us. And here he says, be saved from this perverse generation. The power that Peter has in his sermon here is he's saying, listen, Israel is sinning against God, and y'all have to separate yourselves from the society and from the culture that you're living in right now. You have to stop acting like everybody else. Does that sound like today's news? Something that we need to hear? It does, folks. And I know that a lot of us are sitting here thinking, but I have a loved one that, I know someone that, I work with someone, I care about someone that is involved with, or is addicted to, or is fully convinced that this is okay or that is okay, and I don't want them to think that I'm judging them. The question is, does God think that we are loving him by being truthful to his word? There is a way to love people and still be accurate to God's holy word. Jesus did it, and I know Jesus is perfect and we're not, but he gave us a great example. Loving people. When we talked just a moment ago about Disney and SBC and so forth, we're not talking about hate, and that's exactly what is being passed in our lawmakers' hands these days. And it will come a time when I can't say that without getting in a lot of trouble. We're not talking about hate at all. We're talking about true love. Loving people enough to tell them that this way of life will lead to destruction, eternal destruction. We love them enough to warn them of what's coming and let them know there is a thing called sin, and whether it's politically correct or not, it's accurate and it's truth. And folks, you and I, if we're not careful, will end up as the Church of Laodicea, lukewarm. We identify as the church. This is who we want to be known as, the church. But there is this lukewarm kind of essence to who we are that says we're okay with society. We don't want to ruffle any feathers or rock the boat. We're okay with just letting people be people. But we're the church. Well, not according to Scripture if that's the way we choose to act and to live. The church is a light set on a hill. It's bright in the darkness. It shines. It maintains its standard, who it is, who who she is. We don't acclimate to what's around us and just become part of our environment. If you read on further down in verse 41, it says, "So then those who had received the word were baptized, and they were added to that day about 3,000 souls." Can you imagine? 3,000 people. This was the first time the church had heard the message, had become the church, had received the Holy Spirit, and had started growing. And they were continually devoting themselves to the news broadcast and to the things on Twitter and Facebook. Is that what your translation says? Are you sure? They were devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. What are the apostles teaching? The Word of God. The Word of God. And to fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. These things are so important. They were continually devoting themselves to the things of God. And everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles, and all those who had believed were together and had all things in common. And they began selling their property and possessions and were sharing them with all as one any might have need, and day by day continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house. They were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart, praising God, having favor with all the people. And the Lord, not the programs, the curriculum, the teachers, the charismatic preacher, but the Lord was adding to their number, day by day, those who were being saved. Those who were being saved. It's a continual process, a continual thing. The church was alive, and was alive and well, and Peter's message was, here's the program I want you to follow. We're starting a new church. And here's what we're going to do, and this is the curriculum. We get it from the press here, that just hot off the press, and it's the newest thing. And I want you to share this with people, and that way we're going to grow. We're going to keep up with the demographic. You know, we're working with certain groups of people here. And none of that. He said, repent. Repent. Jesus died for your sins and for my sins. Repent of your sins. Be baptized. Be baptized. Be forgiven. Simple message. 3,000 people responded. I watched Billy Graham the other day on television briefly, in a little blurb off of one of his evangelistic crusades. Billy Graham was not a charismatic preacher. I'm sitting there talking to Stalinist. You know, he wasn't charismatic. He didn't use flowery speech. She said, "You're not Billy Graham." I know that. I know that. But what I'm saying is, he didn't have a gimmick. He didn't have a gimmick. He didn't preach some type of revolutionary new thing that was profound that just came out. He said the same thing over and over again. Jesus is the Son of God. He came to earth to die for your sins. He gave his life so that you could have life. He resurrected again. He defeated hell, death, and the grave so that you could have eternal life. You must confess your sins, repent of those sins, receive his forgiveness, the Holy Spirit, walk with him, trust him, make him Lord and Savior of your life. That's it. And he would usually preach for about 10 minutes, 15 at the most sometimes. A very simple message. What makes the difference? The Holy Spirit was moving in the hearts of people. The Holy Spirit is still moving in the hearts of people. And just like with Peter's sermon, they were broken, folks. That's just not for folks who have never heard the gospel before, who are face to face with their sin for the first time. It's for some of us in the church who have lost our first love. We have become lukewarm in our faith. And sometimes we need to have our hearts broken as the Lord reminds us, your sin is just as despicable to me today as it was when my son died on the cross. It is sin. And we must not become part of this world. We must be in it, but not of it. And I'm not speaking for you today here. I'm speaking for me. And I can tell you by experience, sin destroys. It destroys. It's exactly what God says it is. It does exactly what the Bible says. It destroys. It robs us of our lives. I've had some wonderful wonderful conversations with some people that live near us here lately. And I believe the Lord orchestrated those conversations. I had a recent conversation, and my frustration in that conversation is they're not lost. At least in their mind, in their heart, they're not lost. I can't throw them a life ring or something to bring them to Christ because they don't think they're lost. And it's frustrating. And the more I tried to talk about sin, the more it became a joke. And sin is something that they talked about in the 50s, you know. And I was very frustrated. It is a law or a rule. What's the law in your boats? You have to carry a cushion, a throw cushion. It doesn't necessarily look like this. This hangs on the outside of our boat. It's just a cushion with two handles. You have to have it. But to my knowledge, you don't have to have it tied to anything. Nor this. And sometimes this is our way of dealing with the Great Commission. Make disciples. Okay, I'll throw them a life ring. And we see people sometimes, and we see them sinking, and they're struggling with life, and I'll throw them a life preserver. I hope they catch it, and hope they'll be all right. I gotta go. And we just fling it out there, and Adam, and Jesus loves you. I hope you have a better day than he did, and I'll see you later. And we threw the lifeline out. It's not attached to anything, and there's no after that. It's just, you ever watch people flounder in the water that was drowning or struggling and they needed help? One of the hardest things I ever did in my life was pass a lifeguard test when I was young, in my 20s, early 20s, and our instructor was a Coast Guard retiree, and he thought punishing us was the thing to do. So on our last day, our last test, we had to come save him, and he wasn't a small person, and he brought a jar with him, and in that jar was lard, pure lard. He rubbed it all over himself, and he jumps in the water, and he says, "Now you come get me. If you touch the bottom, you're out. We're in 8 feet of water. If you go to the wall, you're out. You must come and get me and take me to safety. Now you can go to the wall after you get me, but you're going to tread water until something happens, till you save me or till you out." This was the end of our training. This was it. You passed this, you passed the training, you failed this, you failed training. Whew, that was scary. I was terrified. But I had been paying attention to what he instructed us and how to save people's lives and what to do and what not to do. He said, people that are drowning will drown you because their only goal is to breathe. And they're going to climb on top of whatever they can to get out of that water. They don't care that it's their rescuer. They will take you under with them as they're trying to get the next breath. It's just our nature. It's instinct. So I listened to them. And I thought, we were in a place called Happy Lake in Kannapolis. And if y'all are listening on Facebook and you're familiar, you'll recognize that. Happy Lake was spring-fed. Huge, huge pool. But it was spring-fed, which means you couldn't see the bottom. It was sandy at the bottom. Means he couldn't see me when I went under. So I went under, and I went around him, and I got the back of his legs, and I clamped on as hard as I could, and I climbed up him like a tree, and I was pulling him under the whole way, and I kept behind him, and I was climbing up, and I finally got to the top of him, and I put my arm over his shoulder and his chest, and I held on for dear life, because I knew the safety signal was to pinch, and I had to pinch this man before, and he didn't let go, and I thought I was going to drown, so I wouldn't let go of him. I really didn't care if he drowned at the time. I just cared that he wasn't going to drown. So I held on for dear life, but my job wasn't over. I had a hold of him, and I knew that I could get him to safety, but we couldn't stay there. This man was greased up like a pig. and I was doing all I could to hold on to him, and we were at 8 feet of water. So what did I have to do? I wasn't going to let go of my arms. I kicked with all I was worth. I kicked and I kicked and I kicked until we went over to the side where he could be safe and I could be safe. We're not called just to throw the lifeline out to people. We're called to disciple them, to take them to the edge, to go to them and to let them know you are drowning. This will kill you. This will destroy you. You are in the midst of quicksand here. You're going to keep sinking, and one day you're not going to be able to breathe, and that's going to be the end of that. And I don't want to just throw you the lifeline and tell you that Jesus is life. He is, and he's the answer to your problems. But I want to spend time with you, and I want us to go to where you feel like you're safe, and you understand, and you have this faith, and you know who to turn to, and you know who to trust, and pull you along as I'm going through life. Pull you with me until you're secure, you're safe, you know what the deal is, and you can turn around and look at somebody else who's drowning, and you can do the same to them. That's discipleship. That's what making disciples is all about. So, sometimes we think that folks around us aren't in that bad of shape. They're lost and they're in their sin. It's really not that bad, is it? Not that bad. You know, God is a loving God. He's a forgiving God. And maybe one day they'll get right. And it's, you know. You ever been whitewater rafting? Back in the day? Don't remember. Back in the day, whitewater rafting. They carry this bag with them, the guides. If you've been to class 4 or 5 rapids and you have a guide, or you have safety people that are at specific rapids, they have this bag, and it's full of, it's a rope inside the bag, and it's attached to them. You know what I'm talking about? And they watch, and when people are in that turbulence and those heavy rapids, they are watching to see, because sometimes you go over the rapids and it'll hold you there and won't let you go. And they watch, and they take that bag and that rope, and they're going to throw it to you and tell you to grab a hold. They're not going to let go. They're going to tell you to grab that, hold on, and I will pull you to safety. And they do. And they do it often. People appreciate it. And folks, that's us. We're not called to just throw something out to people to say, you're a sinner, you're going to hell, God loves you, you need to repent, see ya. No. He says, you are to make disciples. You throw the lifeline out, you tell them about what God's done in your life. I am a sinner, saved by grace. I could not come to God. I have nothing to offer him. It is all his grace. And he saved me. And one day I'm going to be with him. You start with here. This is where we start. I don't have all the answers, but God does. And he reaches down to us and he saves us. And you start there and you throw them that lifeline and you say, you come with me. I want to take you to safety. I want to talk to you about my Lord. I want to share Christ with you. I want to spend time with you so that you come to know him, and I want to pull you out of that turbulence so you can come to some of the calmer water and you can regain your strength as he gives you your strength, his strength. He lives through you. You yield your life to him. That's what it's about, folks. Saved from what? Sometimes we forget that salvation is exactly that. It means being saved from something. Saved from our sin, the power of our sin, the penalty of our sin, and one day, the presence of sin. Salvation is about being saved from that which destroys. And we are forgetting that sin destroys. And we cannot go down that slippery slope. Peter was talking to people who were in the midst of a culture much like what we're living in. And he says, you have to set yourself aside from these things that are going on around you. Whether you're labeled as someone who is judges or hates or whatever, you can't make those folks not label you. You can love. You're commanded to love. And you're commanded to be a light in this dark world. Not telling people is rebellion, for one, and it's not love. If you see somebody in dire straits and they're losing their life and you don't say something, we don't say something, that's not love. That's selfish. So we have to choose, folks. Are we going to listen to what God's word has to say? Salvation is of the Lord. Being saved from perishing, rescued to save from the evils which obstruct the reception of the messianic deliverance, distractions, traps, from penalties of the messianic judgment. To disassociate from evil. That's what it means. To disassociate from evil. To pull away from those things that God has labeled as being evil. That's what salvation is. Saved from what? Eternal destruction. And that doesn't start after you die. It starts now. Sin destroys. There's a song here. I asked Laurie this morning if she knew where this was, and of course she did, and found it readily. Throw out the lifeline. Throw out the lifeline across the dark way. There's a brother whom someone should save. Somebody's brother. Oh, who then will dare to throw out the lifeline? His peril to share. Throw out the lifeline with hand quick and strong. Why do you tarry? Why linger so long? See, he is sinking. Oh, hasten today and out with the lifeboat away, then away. Throw out the lifeline to danger-fraught men, sinking in anguish where you've never been. Winds of temptation and billows of woe will soon hurl them out where the dark waters flow. Soon will the season of rescue be over. Soon will they drift to eternity's shore. Haste then, my brother, no time for delay, but throw out the lifeline and save them today. We know that the Holy Spirit saves. He convicts, and it's the Holy Spirit that transforms. It is not us. But yet, we are chosen to be the mouthpiece, the one who tells others about the good news and demonstrates it and makes disciples. Right? We have a job, don't we? We have a job. And that is to love others in a way that God loves us. And he says, sin will kill you. It will destroy your life. So here's an alternative. Here's the way of holiness. And Jesus has provided it for all of us. We're going to sing a song that's not a traditional invitational song, but it's a song to get our attention to what's going on. It says, days of Elijah. These are the days of Elijah. We need to be talking about the Lord, telling people about Jesus. Please don't trip on this rope. Sorry. All right. So let's stand and sing. The altar is always open, and I encourage you to come pray. You certainly can pray where you are. Sometimes we need to make an open profession and to say, I need the Lord and I need his forgiveness, or I'm praying for someone else who needs him desperately. Either way, let's sing. Days of Elijah.
Thank you.
for a national convention this week. Keep that in mind. Remember all the things in your bulletin, as we have quite a lot of things going on this week. Invite people to the movie night and senior movie time Tuesday. So it's going to be a great week at the church. Let me pray with you. Heavenly Father, we give you praise for who you are. Acknowledge that you're a mighty God, your creator of all life. Every good and perfect gift comes from you. And Father, I thank you for creating us and giving us the gospel, and for forgiving us of our sins and giving us eternal life. And Father, I pray that we would understand that you have given us the commission to make disciples, and that is not just to tell others, which is certainly an important part, but to walk with others, to teach them, to lead them, to demonstrate before them what the Christian life is about. Father, I pray that you would help us to understand sin is still sin. It's not politically correct, but it is still sin. And I pray that you would help us to identify that in our own lives and to go to others as we know sin destroys, and to love them in a loving way, to let them know that they're headed down a path of destruction and there is an answer. There is a better way. And Father, I pray that you would continue to work in our lives, bring us close to you, and use Homewood Baptist Church and other congregations that may be listening. Lord, use us as your children to further the gospel, to love others, and to carry the Holy Spirit, to be that conduit. And the Holy Spirit can flow through and live in so that others can experience a living God and know beyond any doubt that he exists and still lives today. And Father, as always, I ask you to bless these folks. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace.